If I'm being attacked by five people and it's chaos and I'm pinned against a car and one or two of them is more dangerous than the other, but they're all grouped together and I start shooting, how am I supposed to know exactly which ones are the most dangerous in that scenario when they're all acting as a group?
Yeah. We are the Armed Attorneys. Today we're talking about an unusual but frightening situation if you find yourself in a self-defense scenario against a group of people. We have a case up in Oklahoma we're going to be talking about where it was one gentleman versus five attackers and kind of how that plays out, how it applies to the law of parties, and is self-defense against one justified for self-defense against all? But before we get started, show your support for the Second Amendment by hitting that like button. And today's video is brought to you by our friends over at Grunt Style.
We have a new sponsor with an exciting offer.
Are you looking for apparel that stands for something? Grunt Style is veteran founded and run and has been committed to liberty, patriotism, and freedom. Like us, they take pride in self, the military, and our country.
Their motto, "This will defend," is the same as the U.S. Army's right there on the arm patch. Grunt Style isn't just about tees. They've got pullovers, hoodies, and outerwears for fall, plus loads of new arrival. We've been sporting their shirts for a while now. They're fantastic. Their styles fit both men and women perfectly. I hate looking like I'm wearing like a garbage bag, and it's been fantastic.
Armed Attorney viewers get 20% off site-wide. Go to gruntstyle.com. Use discount code ARM20 at checkout from now until the end of the year, and you can use the code as often as you'd like.
That's gruntstyle.com and then discount code ARM20 at checkout. As you can see, I still have a new Grunt Style shirt on today. This is my messy buns and guns shirt. So thank you, Grunt Style. So we have this homeowner attacked by five individuals pinned up against his car. Let's roll the clip here and you can get a good idea what happened.
I was on the scene Tuesday night reporting on breaking news of TPD responding to the shooting in Hall's front yard in a neighborhood near Apache and MLK. I sat down with TPD's Captain Richard Muhlenberg Thursday, who explained what went down.
About five individuals came onto the homeowner's property and kind of rushed him, pinned him back towards his car, and started to assault him. So with the, you know, overwhelming odds against him, he did pull a pistol out and start firing.
So, I mean, one guy's dead. Another guy is shot, but alive.
For now.
What that clip didn't tell you, which I think is an interesting fact about this case, is that there was an ongoing feud relationship between the parties.
Yeah.
Which is never something that works in the defender's favor. You think it would. You think it'd be like, oh, these guys have been terrible to me for 6 years.
Yeah, we didn't plan on talking about this, but this is a great sidebar.
They're probably neighbors.
Yeah, those situations where you have an ongoing relationship with the person that you're forced to use self-defense against, the way those cases go off the rails are, you know, in your mind, you know, you have all this lead up, you all have maybe this history of violence or capacity for violence, and so you're acting with your specialized knowledge, and then when you find yourself at, all right, time to defend yourself, a lot of times I would just say those incidents sometimes don't stand on their own 2 feet without that additional context. Police prosecutors, they hate that stuff.
Absolutely. And I mean, I will say, if there is this long and storied history, you need to have called the police before.
Yeah.
Because that's what we see. I mean, remember Leslie and I had that guy, he got no bill by the grand jury. He shot and killed his neighbor. I speculated earlier they were neighbors. I actually have no idea. That's just the neighbor ones are the ones that just get the most contentious.
Yeah.
He shot and killed his neighbor, remember? And on its own 2 feet, it did not look good. It was like, well, he started walking towards me quickly and he was on my property and I shot him, which generally is like, but he called the police before. The neighbor was mentally ill. The neighbor had actually like threatened to drive a car through his house and then was like spreading food all over his face, saying he was feeding my client's spirit. It was lots of mental illness, lots of scary stuff. Bunch of police call out. So the fact that police had responded before actually saved his bacon on this one.
Yeah.
Had there been no police contact before, I think he would have been indicted.
Yeah. So if you find yourself in the, I say it comes up in boundary disputes a lot, these neighbor feuds, people not getting
easements,
along.
Easements. God help us with the easements.
But if you observe criminal activity, the time to report and document that is at the time that it occurred. Don't clandestinely collect a dozen incidents and then when it boils over it's like, oh, look at all these things. That doesn't go well.
No, it doesn't. So he was attacked by five people, shot. Richard, what do we need to think about when we think about attacks from multiple individuals.
So the two things that jump out, and we'll start with one of them, the law of parties. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about that. In virtually every single state has a law of parties law. And essentially, and the language will be different, but it'll essentially say, hey, the culpable mental state for one person can be applied to all of these people when they're acting in concert. So the classic example that comes up is getaway driver to an armed robbery at a gas station. Well, even though he's just a getaway driver, you know, they get to, and they will charge that person with the armed robbery itself. They impugn the culpable mental state on him because they're acting as a team.
Right. And in that same vein, we often have a jury charge instruction that goes for the self-defender in these instances, although I will say the self-defender here, not arrested. But if that were to change, I mean, people, how many clients have you had that were arrested and indicted a year, 2 years later after the incident?
It's happening more and more frequently.
You know, you go to trial and your jury hopefully is instructed at your right to shoot at multiple assailants. If they are acting in concert as a group, you shoot at the one who you perceive to be most dangerous. But if you're hitting other ones who maybe aren't the ones pointing the gun at you, hypothetical scenario, you should be allowed to shoot all of them as though they are one actor. Because, like, how can you, which makes sense, right? Like, if I'm being attacked by five people and it's chaos and I'm pinned against a car and one or two of them is more dangerous than the other, but they're all grouped together and I start shooting, how am I supposed to know exactly which ones are the most dangerous in that scenario when they're all acting as a group?
Yeah. And, you know, so we call this defense against one, defense against all. It's an instruction we have in Texas. It's based on case law here. I imagine a lot of other states have something to that effect.
I would imagine so. And, you know, it's, if it works and if your judge includes it for you, because as you may recall, because we've spoken about it before, when you are arguing back and forth about what to put in your charge to the jury, which is the law, right? The jury gets to decide the facts, but the jury is instructed by the court as to what the law is. When you're arguing about what goes in your jury charge, I guarantee the government's going to do everything they can to just, they stick it to you. And the judge is the arbiter of what goes in and what doesn't. Case in point, right? I've got that case on appeal right now in which the jury charge was drafted by the state in its entirety. The judge denied all the defense attorney's requests. Defense attorney in trial did a great job. Judge denied everything, went to the jury. And in fact, the client was charged with one murder, two aggravated assaults, deadly weapon, because he shot at a group of three.
Mm-hmm.
He was acquitted of the murder, because the murderer is the one who had the, or the murderee is the one who had the gun pointed at him, but the other two were acting in concert. He was convicted of those ag assaults because the other two weren't holding the firearm. And so there was no instruction. And our argument is, so he was allowed to shoot all of them.
So acquitted on the murder, convicted of the aggravated?
Convicted of the aggravated assault. So we're appealing the aggravated assaults. And idea being, first of all, he should have been instructed, but also, if you can shoot the guy pointing the gun at you and they're all acting together, he described them like a group of hyenas in a National Geographic video. If you can shoot the guy with the gun, you get to kill all of them, right? If you acquit as to one guy, you have to acquit as the others, and you should have gotten the instruction. We'll see how that goes.
And I think that's probably the underlying idea behind group self-defense, justification against multiple parties. You know, if you would be justified against one person, the law should say you are justified against the entire group that's engaged in the attack.
Absolutely right. So it's scary, though. I mean, this guy, Oklahoma, it's a good two-way friendly state. Everything's going well for him right now. But, I mean, it is a good reminder that your entire fate hinges upon a judge who's going to maybe do the right thing, and then ultimately a jury who's going to say, well, you know, was the guy who actually died, was he really the most dangerous one? Was he just going along with the crowd?
Yeah.
You know, and juries, they're wild. You don't know.
Well, and thankfully, I mean, law enforcement in this case used their better judgment, did the responsible thing, looked at the case, saw it was clear-cut self-defense, used their discretion. A lot of police agencies, that discretion has been taken away from them. And so it makes these situations very, very tough. I mean, this could have happened in any liberal county, and the person could be charged with, you know, one count of murder and four mm-hmm. counts of aggravated assault.
If it had happened in Harris County, if it had been no build in Harris County, they would have hired a special prosecutor to come stick it to him again.
Yeah.
I mean, that is the bluer you get, the more likely you are to have just absolutely absurd, unjust outcomes against the guy who's trying to just defend himself.
Yeah, but good on the self-defender in this case, and we hope you enjoyed this discussion. If you did, consider subscribing, hitting that like button, and help us fight the anti-2A algorithm by sharing this video.
And as always, leave us a question and a comment below. Don't forget to go to gruntstyle.com, use your code ARMED20 at checkout, and until next time, we're the Armed Attorneys.